go to a good place, and not in Brazil. Not that Brazil doesn't have good places, but I think that going abroad is extremely important. You will be exposed to a different culture of science. You know, each country has its own culture of science. Some is more hierarchical, some is more independent, some is, different cultures. Of course, different languages, different reading habits, different seminars, different everything. And I would go to a good place, and there are many good places in the world. Mostly in America, it happens so that America is kind of the big capital of science in the world, even these days. You know, on the East Coast, from NYU to Harvard to Boston to MIT, in the south of the United States to Texas Southwestern, in the west, all the University of California campuses, UCSF, UCSD, and others. In England, you can go to London, to University College in London, to Imperial, Oxford, Cambridge, Sweden, Germany, all the Max Planck Institute. It doesn't matter, really doesn't matter. And choose also a good mentor. But even if you don't have the best mentor, you're in a good environment, so the next door will be a good one. And mostly it's the horizontal interaction. When I was at MIT, we were about 30 postdocs in the lab. And I can tell you that one of them got the Nobel Prize, actually two, including myself. And many of them are members of the National Academy, so you can see what type of postdocs they take, because it's somehow a perpetuating, self-moving machine. That good people take good people, and good people take good people, and you amplify the goods. It's unfortunate for the bad places, but for the less good places. I shouldn't use the language bad places. I should be politically correct. But the best places become very good. The good places become very good, and then they become excellent, and then they excel even further. So that's how the machine feeds itself. So the surrounding around you is excellent. So they have all the technologies, of course they have all the money because they are so successful, so they can buy all the resources, all the equipment, all the imaging, all the model animals, whatever you need. And you'll enjoy a great time there. I mean, you are doomed to succeed. If you are good and you are motivated, you are doomed to succeed. The question is what to do next, of course, because this is the big one. And then whether to go back to wherever you came from, whether the government, the country, the university offers you the appropriate condition to pursue what you learn, because otherwise you lose it. So there is no reason to go to a good place learning something and then coming back and losing it. You want to amplify it and to take it further. I think that people should, you know, for myself, I'm a very Israeli nationalist, so I chose to go back, but my country came and offered me the right position. It may not have been as good offer as I would have received in Stanford, or in other places in the world, but it was good enough to justify going back. Because there are other considerations, of course, family, food, music, culture, language. You want to live with your friends. But if not, stay where you are. I mean, this is not, you know, we are living in a free world, in a small village. Just do what is best for you. But the next thing to do is to move away to a better and a very good place.
Can I add to his question? How, as a PhD student, looking to move to a good lab, do you get yourself recognized by a good lab and get accepted?
Well, at these places you need to have some publications, of course. They will not accept because publication is your kind of entry ticket. So if you have some good publications, one, two good publications, and if you have good recommendations and your mentor is well known, therefore the choice of mentor is very important already at an early stage because it reflects to the future. So people always should think about it. They don't realize it, but it's important. But if you have, I think that the best thing is to have good publications. One, two, you don't have to have numerous. A good publication, and then what you do, in many places they will reject you. They rejected me. Actually, a Nobel Prize rejected me, Günter Blobel.
Nice.
Yeah, he didn't want me. So it's okay, because he had Peter Walter, and so Harvey took me. So he doesn't, well, at that time he was not a Nobel laureate. He got it, I think, in 1997. You will be rejected, but you apply to several places. You know, you write the same application, you write to 10 places. Another thing is that typically these places will ask you to bring your own money. So of course you cannot get it from your pocket. So you have to apply. There are agencies. You learn, you know, going to such places teaches you about the world of science. You write your first grant in order to get your own salary, and there are many agencies, mostly in the United States, Helen Hay Whitney, the Leukemia Society of America, that will foster and nurture young scientists, but they have to be good. So the mentor that you apply to will tell you, okay, I'll take you, but you have to bring your own money, and he will help you to write the proposal and so on. So it's an education already from day one. You're writing your first grant, the background, the reason, the specific aims, the methodology that you are going to approach it. You're not bound to it. You don't have to do it at the end. But nevertheless, we'll get the money. And it's and having the money by yourself gives you also independence. When I came to MIT, I didn't ask Harvey, you know, my mentor, for anything. I brought my own salary. So I could do ubiquity in work. I could work independently on my own project, and I think that at the end, that what brought me the Nobel Prize, because they saw that I can do it on my own. So I worked half on what he wanted me to work, but half I worked on my own. So, you know, from the very beginning, you should be independent. You know, strive to independence. And apply to several places. One will take you, guaranteed. If you are good, one will take you. Don't worry. And if you get rejections, it's okay. That's life.
Thank you.
Next question. Please.
Hello. Hi. Good afternoon. My name is Marcella. I'm a PhD student at Pharmaceutical Sciences graduate program. And first of all, I would like to thank you for being here. It's an honor to have you here. And what I would like to know is, besides winning the Nobel Prize, what would be the greatest achievements of your career besides winning the Nobel Prize? And also, during your research, the development of your research, what would you say were the biggest issues you were faced with, and how would you overcome them?
What was the first question?
What was your greatest achievements in life other than the Nobel Prize?
Prize is not an achievement. The Nobel Prize, it's not me. It's their decision. I didn't decide on it. They give you nice money, so you can make good life, can change your car, do some nice things with it. I think that the biggest achievement in my life is the scientific discovery of the ubiquitin system, which, as I told this morning, I mean, it led to drugs, to curing millions of people worldwide, improving life quality. And we are still in the process. We are at the beginning of the process. There will be many more millions of people that their lives will be rescued by the drugs that will be developed based on the ubiquitin system. So this is the achievement. The Nobel Prize is not an achievement. Somebody decided, give you a phone call, you come, you take the money and the certificate and a medal, and you go home. So the achievement is really it's like a big marathon for this achievement. It took many, many years of very hard work and thinking and frustration along the way and ups and downs. It's like a roller coaster. One day you are at the top, the other day you are in the bottom. But that's the way in science. It's always like that. And you have to persevere. You have to analyze. I never call it a failure. I mean, people say how you deal with the failures. There is no failures. There are lessons. You didn't succeed, then you have to analyze why you didn't succeed. Can be the idea wrong, can be your hands are wrong, can be you made a mistake in calculation. You go back to the drawing board and start all over again. So that's the idea, that's the process, and it's a very healthy process, because without it, if you'll be all the time successful, it means you are a failure. People that are all the time successful, they are a big failure. It cannot be, I simply don't believe it. Because you have nothing to learn from. What are the lessons that you are learning from? So you must fail. It's true in medicine. It's true any area of life. So that's the answer to the second question. All the time there are ups and downs. And even now in the lab, you know, I have now 30 people in my lab, big lab, and we are failing nonstop. But it's a challenge. That makes life interesting. It's not. That's the way it should be. That's a very healthy process of self-learning, of self-analysis, of self-dissection.
Did you ever, during your time in biomedical research, think that you would stop because things were just not going well?
No. It's a too big love. It's really, it's a love, it's a passion. It's not. It's like addiction, you know, you're addicted to it. I always tell young people that people ask me whether I have a hobby. So I said, why should I have a hobby? This is my hobby. My science is my hobby, because I ask them back, do you ask a painter whether he has a hobby? What should I do, collect stamps or what? Well, I'm listening to music. I like the opera. I like Jewish music, but that's in the background. It's I don't put time into it. I collect it. That I put time into collecting it. But I collect watches and clocks. But that's kind of a side when I go to London to some flea market. And the idea is that you don't have a job. You don't have a profession. You have a hobby. And then the university pays you for your hobby, and it's a passion. I mean, that's all my life is science. Day and night, I think about it, I discuss it. Now I devote a little bit less because I travel and do education and so on. But still, I have a very big love, and we are publishing like hell. And look at PubMed, so that's the idea. Therefore, I never lose hope. I mean, I'm never. What shall I do? Become a lawyer? I'm not good at it.
You probably would be good, but never mind. That's another story. Please. Yeah, go for it.
Hi. Hello. My name is Luisa. I'm also a PhD student on
You're
molecular biology.
You're all, by the way, PhD students?
Yes.
Okay, great. Yeah. Wonderful. This is my audience.
And I would like to know, what do you think about the open access journals, Sci-Hub, the free access journals that are starting?
Yeah, I have a very, it's an excellent question. I have a very strong opinion on that. Open access is the only way that we should behave. We should take all these journals and trash them. Science, Nature, Cell, just trash them out. John Maddox, your friend, all of them. Because it's a big injustice to science. It's a big injustice. I don't say that, you know, forget about impact factor and forget about this bibliometric culture, the wrong culture that we evolved because of these journals. You know, these journals are run mostly by non-professionals. You know, look at the editorial board of Nature or Science. Well, Science has a little bit because it belongs to the American Association for Advancement of Science. But looking to Cell, it's all run by postdocs, basically. All run by postdocs. There is not one senior scientist. They cannot judge science. What they do, they send it to reviewers, and then the reviewers send it back, and if you argue, they send it back to the reviewer. They don't have a decision. It's like a post office. So they manage to have good taste, and at the end, they have very good reviewers. But that's not the issue. I'm not talking about that at all. The fact that they implanted and irrigated and fostered and natured and grew this culture to a metastatic cancer. What's really dangerous there is the finances. Think about it. We are sitting now in a public university, right? This is funded by the public. Your fellowships is funded by the public. Your reagents are funded by the public, the electricity, the telephones, everything. Then you publish something, and you publish it in a good journal, in Cell, in Nature. That doesn't matter. You pay page charges. Okay, that's acceptable, that you pay a few thousand dollars to publishing it because it costs them. Well, it doesn't cost them at the end because of subscription. But let's say that it's still okay. And then this university, go to the president and ask her how many millions of dollars the university is paying to subscribing for all the journals that are in the library. Not only life sciences, in engineering, in medicine, in liberal arts, in economy. I can tell you, I'm a member of a very small university. It's only engineering and some sciences. We are only 15,000 students, 600 faculty. We are spending about almost 7 or 8% of our budget, $20 million a year on subscription. So what we are doing, in order that I will read my own paper or the papers of my colleagues, that the money was put already there by the public, I still have to add additional big portion of the public money in order that private publishers, Nature is belong to a private publisher. It's not a public enterprise. Cell belong to Elsevier. Science is a different issue. Science belongs to the American Association of Advanced. There are many journals that that belong to association, but they make their papers, they give free access after a very short time, or PNAS, for example, that belong to the American, to the US National Academy of Sciences. But Cell and Nature, and many others are private enterprises. And the money, you know, I don't want to tell you how much Ben Lewin, the editor of Cell, sold Cell 4 to Elsevier. He made millions of dollars out of it. So this is unacceptable. The alternative is that there will be only one journal. Actually, PLOS is one example of a protest of the scientific community against this tendency. PLOS is called it's Public Library of Science, right? That's the acronym for PLOS. It's free completely. You are putting one-time money in order for the publication, in order to keep it on the server, and it's free for my dog. So my dog, that is well educated to use the keyboard, can go into PLOS and read all the papers. That's the idea, that there will be a complete open access. It's an open access a journal. And I think that we shouldn't give up on peer review. Peer review is very important. Because peer review will select out all artifacts, because we don't want people to fall in trap, to repeat experiments that are non-reproducible and all that. So at least we should have some filter of peer review. But then everything can go into one pot. I don't care. It should go to one single journal that will be called the Journal of Science. That's it.
Okay. So there's some pretty...
And then by electronic keywords and that, you can pull out whatever you like now. You don't read anyway all the journals in the world. There are more than 6,000 journals in biomedicine, 6,000. At the end, every nonsense can be published because the peer review process is going down and down as you are taking a distance from the high impact. It's like, you know, this type of a curve. I don't care that there will be one single open access journal that will be electronic, will sit on one server and people will use it. And then you will be monitored by your citations, if people use it, by the achievements that followed it, drugs, any development. There are measures to assess the value of your science. You don't have to say, I published in Cell in order that people will appreciate you. It may well be that you published some nonsense in Cell. Last week, Nature Biotechnology retracted a paper on CRISPR-Cas, on this Chinese guy, on the NGO Argonaute, that it's a kind of a CRISPR type of an enzyme. Nobody could reproduce it. It was published in Nature. So for a while, the guy was a king, and now he's trashed. So it's just a bad judgment on the reviewer side to go in. And you remember, of course, the case of Benvenisti with the dilution of the water. And I can bring you examples one after the other, about nonsense that was published in the leading journals. So that it's meaningless at the end of the day. I think that the public should have free access to its own property. It belongs to the public. Okay. I'm very sharp on it.
So, as a young scientist, what should you do? Because, I mean, there are some high-profile older scientists who have boycotted it.
You're right. It's not as a young scientist. It's not up to you to decide. You're not out of the game. The scientific community at large should decide that as of tomorrow, what is tomorrow, the 11th? The 11th of August, nobody in the scientific community sends any more papers to these journals. We stop. We are going to empty their emails. But we don't have the guts. We are a weak society. We don't talk to one another. People are after prestige, after accolades, after recognition. It's up to us to decide. The PLOS is one attempt to make such a decision, but it holds only partially. We should be very courageous, I can tell you. In 3 months, they're going to collapse, and either they will go to change their policy or we kick them out of our world. I'm very firm about it, but it needs decision. We deal with it. There is a small group of Nobel laureates, including Hal Varmus, and so on, that we are dealing with this issue, but we are very weak because the scientific community is not with us. Not that they are against us. They just don't, you know, it's very difficult to assemble everybody from southern Brazil to Novosibirsk that they will talk the same language and will have the same opinion. But this is the only way. We need to collapse them, simply to collapse them, either to negotiate with them initially or to threaten them that will be the end. This policy, in my opinion, is unacceptable. Actually, it makes me angry, I must tell you. It does make me angry. I think that it's a big injustice, it's an abuse of public money. We are abusing public money. Think of every university that is spending so much money on subscription. And they are making consortium. These people are smart. So Nature is not Nature anymore. It's NPG. It's Nature Publishing Group. They have 120 journals. Many of them are identified by the word Nature, but many of them are not, like EMBO Journal. EMBO Journal belongs to Nature. EMBO Reports belong to Nature. Oncogene belong to Nature. You don't even identify them. The publisher is NPG. Elsevier.
They have thousands of papers, of journals. And what they force you to buy all of them. So it's all or none. You cannot select. You buy them all. And it costs you enormous amount of money. And the increase in price yearly goes well beyond inflation. So if the inflation is 0.2%, they will hike the prices by 10%. It's unacceptable. It's really unacceptable. But it will require action of the on the side of the scientific community. It's a business. Nature is a business. It is a business. Put it deep into your mind. It is a business.
I used to work for Nature, so feel.
It was not a personal attack. It was not a personal attack on Adam. He realized that it's bad, and then he went away.
I saw the light. It's true.
He saw the light.
Who's next? You, please.
Professor Aaron, my name is Rodrigo Barros. I'm from Nanoscience and Nanobiotechnology. Considering recent advances in technology and medical sciences, would you rather bet on 3D bioprinting or disease prevention by molecular markers, considering starting a new research project?
Would you rather bet on 3D bioprinting or biomarkers for disease? Biomarkers for preventing disease as a research avenue. I guess this is a question you're facing.
Why 3D? I didn't get the 3D printing. The 3D printing is being used, as far as I know, for people who are doing all types of surgery, for reconstruction, for all these type of things. But you know, this is a technology and this is a technology, but why is there not an alternative to one another? Or I misunderstood you.
Yeah, but if you had to choose...
If I have to choose to take one career...
Yeah, because both technologies are...
I cannot advise you. I think that biomarkers... I'm not saying that it's more important. Biomarkers is really, you know, the future. There is no doubt about it in many ways. And we are getting there because it will lead to much early detection than needed. You can imagine that you have a tumor, a tiny small tumor of a few hundred cells, that there is no way in the world to identify it by X-ray, by CT scan, by anything. But if the cells are dying and they're shedding the DNA and you are going to circulating tumor cells or circulating DNA and you can amplify it and find it at a very early stage, then you are a big winner. You are really a big winner. So, and therefore, you know, we started with it a long time ago, but in a very coarse manner. You know, look at the American Cancer Society. I mean, even in Brazil, I think that the Brazilian different patient organization encourage women to go to periodical breast examinations, or men to go to routine prostate examinations, or colorectal carcinoma by looking for occult blood in the stools, or so on. So that's preventive medicine in many ways, but that's too big. Once you are bleeding already in your stools, it can be well too late. The issue is not so much, the technology will come. We shall be able to detect more and more early stage diseases by making the methodology much more sensitive. And you know, even in proteomics, every year we are increasing an order of magnitude. At the end, we should get to Avogadro number. We should be able to discover to get to one molecule. Well, I exaggerate, but we will be able to get to 10 to the minus 20, 10 to the minus 21 as a type of sensitivity. The issue is the coverage, the insurance companies. That's the issue. What they cover and what they are not covering. You may argue that the best logical way is, of course, to prevent a disease or to find it early, to go to I'm not talking complete prevention by appropriate behavior, doing sport, you know, exercise and so on, but early detection. The companies may argue it has to be calculated economically because they have to make their own calculation. So rich people, of course, can do whatever they like. You can do whatever you like. But most of the public cannot afford it. They need to have it under the insurance. Now, the insurance companies are cruel. They want to make money. And they will say that it's better for them to have 10 cancer patients and treating them and cover the treatment and even let them die in agony after 3 years in the hospital than making biomarker test for 10 million every year or so. They will tell us that, taking the entire population of Brazil, or even those that are available in the cities, in São Paulo, Brasilia, Rio, and some other big, Salvador, and some other big cities, and doing it will cost them much more than how many of those people that were detected early would have developed, would have evolved a full-blown disease, and they will need really coverage for their hospitalization. So for them it's economy. And therefore I think that countries should come and tell you what's going on in Israel. Israel has a very good, one of the most advanced in the world health coverage system. Everybody is covered. There is nobody that is not covered. You can be the poorest in the world, and of course the rich pay for the poor, like always. So I'm paying out of my salary an increasing amount up to a cap. Of course it's capped, unlike income tax that never capped. So every dollar you are paying so much, health insurance is capped, but it's capped very high. I'm paying a lot for health insurance, and that's for covering other people that cannot afford doing it. And for that, you get a very rich basket. It's called the health basket, what you are getting for that. So it's you cannot get everything. You cannot get any new technology. You can get some biomarkers, you can get, women can get IVF. You, of course, all cancers are covered, all hospitalization. Chronic hospitalization for the age is not covered because it's very expensive. Mm-hmm. You know, if you have old parents with Alzheimer's, that cannot be covered because that's very expensive. But all the acute type of medicine is well covered. And each year, there is a committee, which is a very sophisticated committee. It's made of physicians, pharmacists, clergymen, sociologists, representative of patients' organization, and the government give them budget, limited budget, and they have to decide which technologies, new technologies will come in and which will go out. It's not always that you have to take it out, but they have to calculate the cost. So if you have, if let's say that there is a recommendation for a new immune therapy drug to melanoma, ipilimumab, I don't know. So they have to calculate that in Israel there are about so many melanoma patients, and about half of them are eligible to the drug because of molecular stratification, and the drug costs $10,000 a month, time this, so this is $20 million. So they say, okay, we approve it, $20 million out of the budget that they got. And then they fulfill the whole budget, and then they go again over the list. And they say, did we exaggerate? Did we decide something? And it's very deliberate. They deliberate for 3 months, always from January to March, and then they say, we have used the budget, and these new technologies or drugs or devices, whatever, will come in and everybody will be entitled for it, and this will go out. If you want to buy it, your problem, use your money, raise money from philanthropy, or whatever. So biomarkers are there too. I think that biomarkers in many ways is the future. 3D is also the future, of course, but of, it's limited. It's mostly of reconstructive medicine, spine surgery, heart, and so on, reconstructive surgery. But I think that the you know, think about Alzheimer's. If we shall be able to find a reliable, with many, with few false positive or false negative, biomarker to Alzheimer's, it will be huge. It will be really huge, because at one day we shall find also prevention. Because the idea to find the biomarker is either to treat the disease or to prevent it, or, so if there will be biomarkers for cancers, for neurodegenerative disease, for heart diseases, we shall be able to prevent it, to treat it. It's a huge market. It's going to be a huge market. Huge.
Next question.
Hello, Professor. My name is Lucas. I'm from Molecular Pathology Graduate Program from Medical School in University of Brasilia. And my question is about, when I was reading about your life and career path, I was very intriguing about technology you have used in your papers, some of them I read. And now, a few seconds ago, you just said about CRISPR-Cas9 technology, which I think it's very, very interesting technology to use in a long future. My question is about, you witness yourself along the years as a scientific researcher, and I want to know how you feel about all this advancement, this big breakthrough in biotechnology, and what kind of advice you gave us about the ethical issues. I mean, recently, Some paper, I think, Nature or Science, they modify human genome from embryos and manipulation of genome. So what do you think about this kind of technique? It's very interesting, but we need to think carefully what we need to do from now.
Yeah,
thank you.
It's a very good one. Let me tell you, I had this discussion many years ago with my mentor when I still was a student. And he told me, Aaron, you know, there are two choices in science. You can either go to basic discovery that will remain forever because the ubiquitin system, that's it. We just discovered it. It has been there for millions of years. Or you can go to technology. And both ways are okay. But you should bear in mind that technology have very short lifespan. I've in my life have gone through so many technologies, I just want to tell you that my PhD thesis I printed on a typewriter. Okay, do you know what is a typewriter? You have seen it in the Museum of Science in Palo, in São Paulo. Yeah. I still have the typewriter with me at home. So, and think about the CD player, and think about everything. Think about the fax. Think about, you know, how many technologies even you as a young person have gone through. Mm-hmm. But technologies are very important because technologies and achievements are going like a cogwheel. They're going side by side. You know, the science all of a sudden stops because it doesn't have the technology to solve the problem. So the technology is driven by the question. You have the technology, then you can make the next step in science. Then the next step in science encounter the same problem. Then a new technology comes. Think about sequencing of DNA. You know, what's his name? Gilbert, the guy who got the Nobel Prize for sequencing of DNA, along with Fred Sanger. Wally Gilbert, from Harvard. So, you know, this was a chemical reaction to discover, you know, the A, T, and C, and G of and now you are doing it with solid state, you can sequence. You know, when I did my first sequencing, when I was a young faculty, I could sequence maybe 200 bases a day. There were big gels that were pouring all over the place, and the reading was complicated. And now you are just giving it to the facility. They can read millions of bases overnight. In the morning, they send you back the results. So the technology changed several times, even of sequencing, since the Nobel Prize was given to Wally Gilbert and Fred Sanger. So, but that doesn't mean the technology is not important. Technology is very important. It's critically important. So first of all, you have to tell yourself, to ask yourself, what do you like to do? I mean, whether you want to be on the fundamental side or you want to be on the technological side. And both are very challenging. It's not, I don't say anything judgmental. It's not any opinion. On the contrary, they are equally important. I decided to be on the fundamental side. But that's my gut feeling. I like eternity. I don't know. So it's more, you know, for me it's like symbolizes eternity. But it's really a matter of taste. The other thing about technology is that people like technology, but that's a danger because they are blinded by it. They think that it's like fireworks. You know, they see all the table, the heat tables of the genes, gene expression, and the screening and so on. At the end of the day, technology is a tool. In my lab, I'm not limited by technology. Whenever I have a need, we do it. Several months ago, we decided to go to the heart. I never worked on the heart in my life. But the cardiologist came to me and we started to discuss, and he wanted to ask some question about the heart. Heart? Okay. So we buy all the equipment, we put the lung valve, everything. We learn what the technology needed and we bring it in. So technologies that are available, not developing of new technology, for me, it's not a limitation. I will always be limited by the question and not by the technology. I'm doing whatever I need to do in order to solve a problem that I'm interested and excited about. I will not let technology put me down, never. So, but you should be very much careful not to be blinded by technology. People are very much excited about tables, about screening, about machines that have blinking lights and so on and so forth. Remember, technology should serve your question. Should serve your question. So the danger is to be blinded. But otherwise, I think it's a matter of real gut feeling, what you are good at. There are people that are good at it, that understand the mechanics and the electronics and the calculation and the mathematical base behind it and the algorithm that they have to be developing. and so on. I'm weak in I'm very weak in abstraction, so I know my weaknesses. I never succeeded in mathematics. I cannot calculate anything. I have to see it. So I decided that I will go to something that I to see gels. You know, if I see a gel, I understand. So it's a matter of, you know, but you have to close your eyes and to give yourself a report and to have an insight of what you are really good at in order to decide where to go.
Thank you. We have questions queuing up now. So one this
we have
side
one more because we are on the way to the airport.
Well, we can do.
You can come with us to Rio.
If you give short answers, we can have two more or three more. So
yeah, okay. I want to be.
I know.
To give a full answer.
I know. We appreciate that. That's good.
Yes.
My name is Dalila. I'm from the molecular biology program. I'm a PhD student as well, and recently there are a few works coming out about the state of mental health in scientific careers and post-graduation. What is your opinion about this type of discussion that are coming out?
So she's mentioning that there's discussion of the state of mental health in people when they're graduating or doing PhDs or postdoc. So I suppose it's about the fact that it's a depressing career.
Yeah, it's a real issue. I mean, I just read that there was an article, I can send it to you in the mail, just last week. Science has a very good, if you read science, it's showing up weekly. Actually, tonight you can see the science of this week. So it's coming out always in the United States in the night between Thursday and Friday, always. So for me, it's like waking up Friday morning, that's the first time I do, the first thing I do, going to science. And there is a section in science that is called careers. Every aspect of young scientists' careers, salaries. And last week was on depression of graduate students and so on. It was very interesting. I didn't realize the extent of the problem. And they analyzed the issue of what's going on there. It can be failure in your work, it can be the attitude of your mentor to you, fights with the mentor, and so on and so forth. I cannot give you an advice because I must admit that, not that I'm mentally sane, I wouldn't declare it for sure. You need a doctor to tell you that. But I never faced it, but I realized that it's a growing problem, But I can tell you what I still learned from my own career that is not related to this issue, that if you feel bad somewhere, like I felt a little bit bad in medicine, that I am not fulfilling my, you know, that it's not me, that I don't belong there, I felt like foreign, go away. Just go away. If you feel that your mentor is not treating you nice instead of discuss, you know, you can start discussing, just go away. If the university doesn't like, so go to Rio, go take a distance, you know, just change it. It can be an internal problem too, so you may ask for help. I mean, not you, I mean, you should always, you know, we should be very open, you know, mental states. I'm not saying about insanity, I'm talking about depression, by the way, is one of the biggest issues in current medicine, because it costs the market worldwide hundreds and hundreds, if not trillions of billions of dollars. Because just the fact that people are slowing down or cannot get up in the morning to work, or just working in 60% efficiency rather than 100%, is a huge damage to the market. And we don't know what's the reason behind, you know, it can be anything. So as a physician, I always learned that the only way to cure a disease is to admit that you have it. So if you feel bad, first of all, ask help. I mean, not you again, I mean, I'm talking about the So you know, to admit it, to be transparent, you will get help from friends, you will get help from family, you will get help from professionals. Always, you know, hiding it is always worse, because it will then self-perpetuate, it will self-accelerate. If it's a problem with a mentor, try to solve it. If not, go away. But, you know, it's like, I'm a surgeon, so surgeons have this character of solving problems, because surgery is black and white. You cannot have the patient bleed and say, okay, let's wait. You don't wait. You go in. So it's the same with abscess. When you have an abscess, you know, the only way is not to cure it with the warm bandaging or what. You have to go in to cut it, to drain it, and to dry it, and to, you know, you have to be very sharp about it. So I believe that this is the way in every problem. If you have a problem, at first of all, admit it and look for help. And the help can come from different circles. It can come from family, it can come from friends, it can come from a boyfriend, from a girlfriend, from whoever. And first of all, define the issue and then... But I realize that nowadays people are healthy people feel very stressed because it's job, it's what to do next, it's how to choose a career, it's how to do that, it's how to do that, and then marriage comes in between, and one spouse takes it this direction, another. I remember my own life. I mean, when I got married, I was married to, still married happily, to a career-oriented woman, very career-oriented woman. She's a physician, a senior physician, a department chairman, and you know, I was had to wait for her until she finished her residency, and only then we went to the postdoc. And during the postdoc, I had to make sure, not I, both of us, that she will also have a job in the same city. So we picked up the city according to availability for her. She studied at Harvard School of Public Health. So it's about accommodation and about admitting and talking and discussing and solving it. After all, we are all human beings, and the problems are not as long as we are really healthy. I always say, as long as I don't have cancer in the brain, I'm okay. I'm really okay. It's to take things in proportion. I mean, this is a solvable problem. You can solve it. So, but hiding it is the worst. Hiding it is the worst. And in medicine, it's against the profession. Medicine is about helping, about curing, about alleviating. So it's counter to medicine. Because I'm coming so far, I'm deeply embedded in the medical world, and it's counter to the medical philosophy that the problem should not be surfaced. And of course, there is a lot of confidentiality. There should be confidentiality between the patient and the caretaker. That's the basic. Of course, we are not there to gossip or anything. But I think also that this is on the side of the graduate student, postdoc, young scientist. On the side of the mentors and the institutions is also to look into it. Because until now, graduate students were looked at as slaves, as not slaves, as working power. It's a stage in your career, you come for 5 years, you do your job and you go, you're not a part of the permanent staff. I have a different attitude to my grad students. I'm kind of their friend to an extent. I have an open door. They can always come and talk and blah, blah, and do whatever they like. So they feel that they have a home behind them. So it's not only the problem of the young scientists to handle, it's also the problem of the institutions and the mentors to handle. And in our institute, we have courses for the mentors of how to handle graduate students. What to do with them, what to do with the problems, to ask them. So each half a year or so, I interview them in person. I said, I'm not saying are you depressed? I'm saying if something bothers you or you want to share with me or there's a problem or whatever. So they should get a good feeling about where they are. They work very hard for their career. And it's still very unstable because they don't know where they go, They have to go to a postdoc and after the postdoc they have to get a position and then to fight on the tenure and grants and their own students. So I try to And I do it as a part of my educational mentality because I always look at my students as future mentors, so I want them to be good mentors. So I kind of get so it's but it's an issue. You're right. It's an issue. It's a growing issue, especially with the tension in science these days. I think.
I don't like stopping on the subject of depression, but I think
it's not just depression, but read science. I think from last week or 2 weeks ago, look under, if you go to PubMed, you can take, I think it's even mental state, the work was mental state or depression, you can put a keyword and then you can put the name of the journal and it will pop up.
I think, and I'm sorry for those who wanted to ask questions and haven't had time, I'm really sorry. But I think it's very revealing that you do give such long answers, very well thought out, and you're thinking as you're talking, and it's revealing about you and the way you think about problems to listen to you answer these questions. So there's something else to learn above your answers, just in the way you answer. Anyway, it's been a fantastic session. Thank you all for taking the trouble to come and for your lovely questions.
And good luck in your career.
And thank you, Aaron. I reckon that people might just want to take a quick photograph with you if they come and stand here, if they can. So.
No, there were good questions.